Elon Musk is a man on a mission. He wants to start a colony on Mars, but is it possible? We don't know. But what we do know is that together with his team of SpaceX employees, they will have to reimagine current technologies and invent new ones if they want to achieve this. This is where the Raptor engine comes in. Hello and welcome back to our Space and Future. Today, we are going to take a look at the new Raptor engines developed by SpaceX. What makes this rocket engine better than all the others? Stay tuned to find out. Don't forget to leave a like and subscribe to this channel for more videos. And with that said, let's get to it. The Raptor engines could be enough to power Elon Musk's plan to reach Mars. His plan is to land on Mars by 2024. However, do not confuse these Raptor engines with the Merlin engines that SpaceX uses on the Falcon 9 reusable rockets. Currently, the Merlin engines are the ones being used for all recent launches. However, the Raptor engines are being developed specifically for SpaceX's Starship and its booster stage, the Super Heavy. But how are these engines being made? For us to understand how we got to where we are in terms of rockets, we shall first have to look at the past. Rockets can be traced as far as the medieval ages, but the rockets we are talking about can be traced back to about 1898. This is when Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, a Russian schoolteacher, first proposed the idea of using liquid propellants in rockets to explore space. Tsiolkovsky was of the idea that the exhaust velocity of escaping gases limited the speed and range of a rocket. He was dubbed and is now known as the father of modern astronomy because of his vision and intensive research. He was the first ever person to dream of going beyond Earth's atmosphere. All this while strapped to a tube of burning gases. A few decades later, rockets were already being developed all over the world. However, instead of Tsiolkovsky's idea of launching beyond the atmosphere, they were being developed to be used as weapons. Engineers like Robert H. Goddard from America and Hermann Oberth from Germany later established the principles for developing rocket engines. Later on, after the Great Wars had ended, a whole new field of study in rocket technology started developing. Thanks to the Cold War, the space race was greatly challenged. This meant that a whole new era of technological development was beginning in the field of rocketry. Rockets that would be used to break free of Earth's gravity and escape velocities started being designed. However, it started proving to be very difficult to go up against gravity. On October 4, 1957, the Sputnik rocket successfully defied gravity and delivered the first artificial satellite known as Sputnik 1. Sputnik was a highly modified version of the Soviet Union's R-7 Semyorka ICBM. This was when they realized that Sputnik could travel up the Earth's gravity. Shortly after, the USA developed the Saturn V rocket, which was used to deliver the first people to the moon. Soon after, countries like China, India, and the EU Space Agency started developing their own rocket designs. They were all being developed for one task only, to get through the Earth's gravity and enter space. For some time now, SpaceX has had its eyes on Mars, trying to figure out how to get there. This has led them to rethink their rockets from the ground up. They have figured out a way to build rockets that would take people to Mars and come back to Earth. This would require a new rocket using new engines. They started the development of a stainless steel alloy-based spaceship, currently known as Starship. Previously, it was known as the Big Falcon rocket. Starship is supported by a booster stage called the Super Heavy. They had the idea, they had the design. Now all they needed was a powerful enough engine to power this. Even as they were going through the production process, they had one thing in mind. The rockets would be reusable. They thought that NASA was just dumping millions of dollars of equipment into the ocean with their one-time use rockets. They also put the cost into consideration and concluded that developing reusable rockets would be a better option. Through years of hard work and lots of sweat and blood, they finally made reusable rockets. The Falcon 9S are now the industry standard for reusable rockets. With the success of the Falcon 9 rockets with Merlin engines, SpaceX decided that they would not change, but instead go on in the same path of reusable rockets. SpaceX was serious about reinventing rocket engine technology. They developed the Raptor engines using the full flow stage combustion cycle. SpaceX decided to use the theoretical and experimental gas cycle in their new engines. This would be the first engine to put the cycle into practice and actually go to space. In simple terms, this cycle uses both oxidizer-rich and fuel-rich pre-burners. In other rocket engines, it is one or the other. The name comes from the way that both propellants flow through the turbines. The Raptor engine has more control over the flow of oxidizer and fuel, making it even more efficient than other rocket engines. Other benefits of the full flow stage combustion cycle includes turbines that run cooler and at lower pressure too. This is due to the increased mass flow. In the long run, the engine has more life and is highly reliable, which was SpaceX's goal all along for the Starship's engine. Such an engine means that it can be used and reused multiple times without the need for servicing. This significantly cuts down on costs and downtime between launches. Currently, the Raptor engine is said to go for about 25 flights. If they were not reusable, that would mean 25 different Starships for the same flights. The engineers also decided to use cryogenic liquid methane to feed the Raptor engine. This is not the same for other rocket engines. The fuel of choice for these rockets is Rocket Propellant 1, or RP1, which is a more refined version of jet fuel. Falcon 9's Merlin engine and Kestrel engines both use RP1. The announcement of using cryogenic liquid methane and liquid oxygen, or LOX, came as a shock to most SpaceX fans. However, SpaceX was already committed to using methane as the primary fuel for the Raptor engines. This decision was greatly influenced by the geological landscape and atmosphere of Mars. Starship was mainly developed to be used for Mars missions. NASA's rover missions to Mars showed that Mars's atmosphere has huge amounts of CO2 in the air and huge deposits of frozen water underground. At this point, SpaceX realized that in theory, they could synthesize their own methane on Mars. If SpaceX were able to make their own fuel on Mars, this would mean that they do not have to haul fuel for the return journey. This is known as in-situ resources utilization, ISRU, ISRU. This is a way to exploit local resources to put in a sustainable infrastructure on an alien planet. This goes hand in hand with SpaceX's aim to make Mars a sustainable colony without depending on Earth. The Sabatier process, which is the process of making methane from carbon dioxide in water, could be used to make fuel for the Raptor engine since it produces oxygen as a byproduct. The oxygen could be used by the colony for survival also. Astronauts, to produce oxygen from water and eliminate carbon dioxide, have already tested this process on the International Space Station, ISS. Some of you may be wondering why we cannot use hydrogen to power the engine. To explain it briefly, even though hydrogen is more efficient, it adds complexity to rocket engines and designs. In addition, liquid hydrogen needs extreme temperature control, can leak easily, and is less dense, hence requiring a bigger fuel tank. SpaceX wants to build a rocket that is simple, cheap, and reliable. Elon Musk said, "The best part is no part. The best process is no process." In the end, SpaceX decided to use methane instead of hydrogen. Methane burns with a bright blue flame, giving it a different sight from the yellow flame of the RP-1 powered engines. Therefore, the Raptor engine has a unique signature look. The first test of the Raptor engine was at the SpaceX Boca Chica facility. They carried out a hop test using the SN5 Starship in August 2020. The SN5 flew to a height of 500 feet before landing safely on a single Raptor engine. Following the success of this test, SpaceX decided to perform more tests throughout 2020. On December 9, 2020, they decided to perform a high-altitude test for the Raptor engine fitted to the SN8 Starship. It was fitted with three Raptor engines as they tested it in the same facility. They achieved a height of 10 kilometers, which was a great milestone. However, on landing, one of the Raptor engines failed to reignite, leading to its crash and explosion. The engines failed again in another high-altitude test carried out in February and March 2021. But something we know about SpaceX so far is that they never stop until they accomplish their goal. On May 6th, SN15 landed successfully after a high-altitude test. Share your thoughts on the new Raptor engines in the comments section below. Also, don't forget to leave a like and subscribe for more awesome videos. Until next time.